Hello everyone, welcome to Managing Regulatory Compliance and Other Challenges for Tablet Dissolution Testing, a Global Perspective, presented to you by Pharmatest. My name is Björn Fehle, I am CEO of Pharmatest. So let's go over the agenda. First, I will give you a brief introduction about Pharmatest. Then in part two, our head of product management, Dr. Dirk Balke, will talk about dissolution validation, especially about the global regulatory requirements. He will present the critical control points. Part 3 is the practical part where Mrs. Katrin Ulrich, our method and application specialist, will show you mechanical and chemical calibration in practice. Finally, in part 4, a global perspective, partners from around the world will share their experience regarding challenges, developments and trends. Pharmatest was founded over 40 years ago. And we are a leading manufacturer of high-value testing equipment for the pharmaceutical, food, and cosmetics industry worldwide, made in Germany. Our worldwide distribution network consists of over 100 partners and subsidiaries. We offer a complete product range. From manual physical testing instruments, to fully automated analytical test systems.
On the next slides, I will show you what is typical application of tablet dissolution testing and why it is so widely used. And you will see why dissolution test is so important in quality control departments of pharma, food, and chemical industry. The dissolution test is an important quality control test in pharmaceutical industry. It is a test which discriminates between batch qualities in a robust and low-cost procedure. It is also one of the last tests before deciding whether the product can be released to the market. This is a reason why the dissolution test procedure, including the instrument, is one of the most strictly regulated quality control tests in pharma industry. Another important application for dissolution testers are comparative studies, which are mainly used for the approval of suitable generic drugs and stability measurements. The so-called biowaivers are globally used to reduce costs for the drug product. A comparative study requires a test of 12 samples. F2 statistics are used. The biowaiver monographs are published in the Journal of Pharmaceutical Sciences. Dissolution testers can be also found in all pharmaceutical R&D departments where dissolution methods for the quality control are developed. In vitro and vivo correlation and research for new dosage forms are performed. We see here on the left graph the typical elimination profile of an in vitro in vivo correlation. On the right side, we see the dispersion releaser, which is used for the test of nanoformulations. Worldwide, all responsible authorities have rules for the dissolution test procedure. Most of these rules have been harmonized in the last 20 years. On this slide, we see an overview over the most important authorities. We have the European Pharmacopeia and the European Medicines Agency, EMA, as well as the USP and the USFDA. We also have the ASTM, where the dissolution test is mentioned under ASTM E2503. We have the World Health Organization, WHO, the Chinese Pharmacopeia, and the Japanese Pharmacopeia. The USP guidelines for the dissolution testers can be found in chapters 711 and 1092, and additional official documents such as the toolkit for mechanical calibration of the apparatus 1 and 2. In the dissolution toolkit for mechanical calibration, the USP mentions that a successful performance of the tests will satisfy OQ and parts of the IQ. PQ may be satisfied by a performance verification test. In European Pharmacopeia 2.9.3, The solution apparatus such as pedal and basket are described, whereas transdermal test systems are described under 2.9.4. We see here also some small differences. An example is the extraction cell, which is one of the apparatus which can be used to test transdermal dosage forms. The US FDA has published a guidance for the mechanical calibration of dissolution test apparatus 1 and 2 in the year 2007, with an update in 2010. It is recommended to perform a calibration every 6 months. Chemical calibration as well as mechanical calibration should also be performed if a unit is moved or when there has been a major change made to the instrumentation. In the FDA document for mechanical calibration of dissolution testers, it is mentioned the enhanced mechanical calibration procedure recommended in this guidance can be used as an alternative to the current apparatus suitability procedure for USP dissolution apparatus 1 and 2 described in USP General Chapter 711 Dissolution. It is also mentioned, regardless of whether the enhanced mechanical calibration procedure or apparatus suitability procedure is used, the guidance also recommends that appropriate measures be taken to control the following sources of significant variability in dissolution testing: dissolved gases, vibration, and vessel dimensions. There are two main regulations concerning electronic records and data integrity from US FDA. One is for 21 CFR Part 11, and the other is for data integrity. The main requirements for 21 CFR Part 11 is the password security, is user management, the audit trail, and electronic signatures. Whereas data integrity also requires the compliance of 21 CFR Part 11, but also focus on data security during the product lifecycle. Alcoa rules are mentioned, and these are attributable, legible, contemporaneous, original, and accurate. In STM, there is also guidance for the mechanical calibration of dissolution testers. It is mentioned here under 2.2. Once a unit meets all of the mechanical specifications, including in this practice, it is considered calibrated, and further calibration with dissolution calibrator tablets is not required. On this slide, we have summarized the critical control points for dissolution systems. We have the mechanical calibration, which includes, for example, tests for temperature and rotation speed, the software critical control points, which are mentioned in 21 CFR Part 11, and the regulations for data integrity. In addition to this, there are other important control points such as vibration levels, amount of gases in the media, sampling time points, and others. As you have seen, there are many regulations for dissolution testers, most of which are harmonized, but there are still exceptions. Our dissolution testers are designed to meet all requirements for enhanced mechanical calibration as well as for data security management. My colleague Katrin Ulrich will give you now some more detailed information about mechanical calibration and chemical calibration. Please enjoy.
I will start with the mechanical calibration, as this part of the qualification has to take place before the chemical calibration test. In general, the physical calibration includes the following tests. In the first place, the instrument has to be aligned horizontally, and the immersion depth of the steering tool has to be adjusted. The steerer speed, as well as the vessel and steerer shaft verticality of each steerer, has to be checked. The centricity between vessel and shaft is a factor which has a high influence on the dissolution test and its results. The last two tests include the wobble measurement and of the used steering tool, like mostly the USP1 basket and USP2 pedal apparatus, and at least the temperature measurement of the water bath and the vessel temperature. We know that there are slightly different tests described depending on the pharmacopoeia and regularities, but through testing all these 7 parameters, we ensure the quality of the instrument and its results. Therefore, we always set the highest standards based on the most strict official regularities. Before starting with the mechanical calibration, you have to check whether your dissolution tester is ready to work. In the first step, it is important to fill the water bath of the dissolution tester with demineralized water up to the maximum filling level. In addition, it is strongly recommended to use an algicide to prevent an alg growing. Alg growing can cause an influence on the tubing and pump lifetime and thereby on the heating capability of the dissolution tester. As soon as the water bath is filled, you can start the dissolution tester and turn on the pump to heat up the water bath to approximately 37.3 degrees. Now take the vessels and put them inside the intended position of the water bath cover and fix them. As a last step, take the steering adapter and fix it hand tight at every steering position. Before starting further tests, you have to align the dissolution tester horizontally. Place the digital level on the mentioned positions on the water bath cover and correct deviations by adjusting the feed height. We are following strict tolerances, so a maximum deviation of 0.1 degrees is allowed here. It is possible to adjust all 4 feeds with the spanner to align the instrument properly. In general, the alignment of the instrument ensures that the tablet can fall into the right position in the middle of the vessel. You have to check the immersion depth of your steering tool. The tolerance for the immersion depth of each vessel is 25 mm plus minus 2 mm. This is the distance between the vessel bottom and the lowest part of USP apparatus 1 and 2. These depth adjustment balls are carefully dropped into each vessel. Loose the black screw at the top of the dissolution adapter by unscrewing it and carefully push it down until the contact is given. In the next step, you are now able to qualify the steering speed at each stirrer. Therefore, use small adhesive tape which is placed at the black screws. According to USP, the maximum allowed tolerance is plus minus 1 RPM for 50 and 100 RPM. Now use a laser tachometer to aim the tape on the black screw. Start the rotation of the stirrer at 50 RPM and hold your hand still during the measurement. Measure for approximately 30 seconds until your received steering speed value is constant. Now repeat this for every steering position at different speeds. Another important calibration procedure is the vessel and stirrer shaft verticality. A digital protector is used to check the verticality of the vessel. Measurements are made on the vessel's inner surface. Measure at 2 points where the deviation is not allowed to be higher than 0.5 degrees. The same condition is valid for the shaft verticality. Here you are using a digital level to measure at 2 points with the same tolerance of 90 degrees plus minus 0.5. A perfect fitting of the centricity ensures that the dissolution test can take place under uniform conditions. The test is done at 25 RPM to receive the exact deviation and at 2 measurement points, 2 mm and 8 mm above the pedal. You can easily check this by using a digital caliper to measure the distance from the pedal rod to the vessel inner wall. Use an additional centering cover to check if the pedal is hitting the middle of the vessel. The tolerance here is plus minus 1 mm during a total revolution of the stirrer. Another important check is the stirrer and basket wobble. Here you measure the swing of the used apparatus USP1 and 2, which is not allowed to be higher than 1 mm in total. Therefore, you are using a wobble meter and a precision dial gauge, which are positioned on the water bath cover. Now at 25 RPM, the dial gauge measures the maximum wobble of the apparatus in each direction. Before starting the temperature measurement, you have to fill 500 ml of demineralized water into each vessel and cover it up to prevent evaporation. Wait minimum 30 minutes until the temperature equilibrates with the water bath temperature. Now measure the temperature in the water bath itself and in each vessel. The deviation between the maximum and minimum measured value in the different dissolution vessels has to be plus minus 0.4 degrees according to USP. As mentioned in the table before, the vibration has a huge impact on the solution testing. FDA and USP also warn against the high influence of vibrations due to the solution testing and want to prevent those. To minimize the impact, it is common to use vibration absorbers at the dissolution tester feet and also below the water bath. The usage of high quality products and a high weight ensures that the dissolution testers are more robust, like mentioned by the USP. Before you are starting with the dissolution test, you have to apply the prednisone standard. The performance verification test is not valid if you are not using the prednisone standard to verify your test results. You are creating a standard with a defined amount of prednisone, so you finally know the concentration of your standard as well as the absorbance you are receiving with this concentration within a spectrophotometer. With this information, it is easy to check samples with an unknown amount of prednisone. How to apply the standard is a well-documented procedure by the USP. After preparing and analyzing the standard, we are ready to start prednisone test. The water bath is already filled with water and algicide, so can now turn on the pump to heat up the water bath to approximately 37.3 degrees. Fix the USP apparatus of choice, pedal or basket, at every steering position, and go on. While the dissolution tester heats up, you take care of your media used for the prednisone test. Regarding to USP and FDA, the media should be degassed prior to testing the prednisone tablets. The FDA is even more specific by saying that less than 60% of saturation should be left of total dissolved gases, which corresponds to 6 mg per liter. The graphic here shows the influence of the oxygen level on the amount of dissolved prednisone. You can see that an oxygen concentration of 8 mg per liter results in the solution values more than 20% higher than with 6 mg per liter or less. This is why the maximum oxygen level is limited to 6 mg per liter. The first test we are showing here is the prednisone test with the USP apparatus 2, the pedal. Please take care that the tablet is carefully released from its packaging to prevent damage. As the tablet insert is done manually, you can use a staggered start to be in the sampling time interval. You will have 30 seconds to take all samples after 30 minutes of dissolution. Start the test as soon as the tablet reaches the bottom of the vessel. As you can see, after 10 minutes of dissolution, the tablet cone shape is different between both vessels here. The left one forms an adequate cone as it dissolves in degassed media. As you can see on the right, there is no cone and the tablet residues are swirling through the vessel. Here we used non-degassed media to show the impact on the prednisone test, which leads in much higher amounts of prednisone dissolved. Compared to the pedal test, the prednisone test with baskets is slightly different in its application. You have to screw the holding bracket of the basket onto the steering rod. The tablet will be placed in the basket. Please check that the bottom of the basket arches slightly outwards to prevent that air bubbles can hide here. Now clip in the basket into its holding bracket, remove the vessel covers, drive down the dissolution tester in its test position for USP 1 and 2, and start the steering movement. After 30 minutes, you will have 30 seconds to take all samples here. The sampling is done by a small tube with a connected syringe to pull out the media manually. According to USP, the performance verification test must be done by manual sampling. Now, after all samples are taken, you have to measure them within a spectrophotometer to figure out the real content of prednisone dissolved in each vessel. Fill all cuvettes with the corresponding sample and measure them at 242 nanometers in a cuvette with a path length of 10 millimeters. In case your performance verification test was successful, you receive a non-changeable sheet which includes your entries and your final test results. This certificate is necessary to prove that the dissolution tester passed the performance verification test. For example, you can see here two different performance verification test results for both basket on the left and pedal on the right. These are just example certificates from older batches. The performance verification calculation tool calculates the geometric mean and coefficient variation based on your entered data and thereby confirms if you met the tolerances or not. This certificate can be printed or saved digital and is your confirmation that the performance verification test passed. After printing it, the performer of the performance verification test must sign the certificate at the bottom to prove that he did the test and that all entries were done truthfully. So, congratulations! The mechanical and chemical qualification of your dissolution tester is done and you are now able to run your analyses of generics or develop new methods or formulations. Now at the end of the qualification process, I want to give you a short conclusion regarding the chemical qualification. Since the year 2010, the USP tolerances are relatively narrow, so even small errors can cause that the test will not pass. Like shown before, there are a lot of factors that can influence the performance verification test, such as vibrations, the oxygen content of the media, the steering speed accuracy, a possible media contamination, the sampling position, the filtration of the sampling during taking and before analyzing it in the spectrophotometer, and even more. Please make sure that only well-trained personnel carry out the performance verification test. Thank you.
We have asked some of our international partners to share their perspective. Please enjoy.
We can start talking about the big multinational companies. We'll talk about the GSKs. We can talk about the Mercks. We can talk about the BMSs, where once they had manufacturing in the U.S., that manufacturing has now left the country and gone to other parts of the world.
It's quite interesting because a lot of the established big companies are sort of in a bit of remission, I suppose. I mean, Pfizer was probably the exception that proves the rule.
We had a lot of the bigger international, multinational companies located in certain areas of Australia which have actually moved their tablet production or generic production to another country or overseas. There have also been some that are actually contract manufactured to other places within Australia, but there are several international, multinational companies which have stayed within Australia.
Any small local pharma companies either are taken away by the multinational company, or the big local pharma will take over the small local pharma company. Yeah. Multinational company prefer to buy the small pharma because the regulation would be easier for them to comply, rather than they set up a new plan, because the new plan will take a lot of validation and a lot of time for preparation, and this will cost them more money.
What we're seeing with the big multinationals is that they still have their R&D facilities here, their centers of excellence, whether it's Pfizer, BMS or Merck.
We have here in the Netherlands, also Belgium, we have, let's say, many spin-offs of universities, so small companies. Some of these small companies get really big. We had one, I think, the last 10 years, this company was called Synthom. I can remember when I sold at the first dissolution test, there were only 14 people working over there, and within, I think, 5-6 years, they had something like 2,000 people.
Ukrainian markets, it's approval by generic drugs.
We're seeing a big growth in terms of generic companies, a lot of those coming from India.
The large Indian manufacturers are now moving into, they're filling the gap where Sandoz left the market, but Aurobindo and Dr. Reddy's and Granules are now entering the market.
The generics market is not to be sniffed at because it's worth a lot of money every year, and more materials are falling, if you like, out of their current certifications, so they're open for generic copying.
Generics drugs, they of course need to in vitro test, and they want the dissolution testers. It's the main market in Ukrainian make generics drugs.
We've seen more and more 12-position dissolution testers being sold, and what I can say is that the current interest in 14-position machines is actually quite exciting at this point. The first two that we've sold have been primarily because not only does the customer want to run, six capsules, maybe gelatin capsules, it's obviously got sinkers and whatever, but the requirement is also now to run some of the actual empty capsules, so the hard gels themselves, run those in position number 7 as the blank. And that, of course, opens up a fantastic door for us because we can now do batch comparison. We can actually do biowaivers with not only if you like, the 6 plus 6. We've now got the 7 plus 7, so we can cater for all of those particular requirements.
I think in the future, the market for pharma industry in Indonesia is very bright because we have a lot of population, and also aging population is now one of the main issue.
We're seeing a jump in dissolution testing in the supplement world. US FDA is starting to come or starting to offer some guidance on dissolution testing with supplements.
Our local some interesting drugs, it's usually content from herbals or dietary supplements.
The biggest industry in our region at the moment and growing is basically the complementary industry. R&D laboratories in this field have specific requirements for dissolution equipment. They always talk about reliables. They have some things that are extended dissolution profiles. They need something that's reliable, easy to use, quality of apparatus, and the continuous use, and also the access in between, say, something simple in between the stirring head and the actual vessels. So when they have to do something, that they can quickly go in and out and do it, because it is quite a fast-paced industry.
Validation is one of the most important topic now in Indonesia, actually. And the current challenge at the customer side is how to perform the PVT with the prednisone tablet.
How we started our business was service. We would go in and offer services on anybody's dissolution bath, performing maintenance, calibrations, PVT testing, and enhanced mechanical testing.
For us, it's not just a bath, but a tool for a complex application. It contains mechanical, electronic, liquid flowing parts which have to perform within tight limits.
In the Benelux, it is quite common that you offer validation services. What I discovered, customers, that they really appreciate that PharmaTest is offering these documents for free.
Our service engineers come to them with equipment, with certification, and make all installation, all qualification, and all validations that the customer asks.
So they have to know what a dissolution profile is, how they come by this dissolution profile, what is it used for, why the mechanical calibration, also why is the PVT verification done, and also a bit of research knowledge or involved in research so they know what are the limitations or what can be done or what does this encompass and what needs to be done later on or in the future.
I cannot remember the English word now, but the Dutch say ontzorgingsconcept. You arrange everything for the customer. You make sure that everything is okay. You fill in all documents, and then you can start immediately using the equipment. You help them to get them going.
As of late, there's two ways to calibrate a dissolution system. There is the traditional way where we're called the performance verification test, which was created by the United States Pharmacopeia, where we're dropping calibrator tablets, and these are the prednisone tablets. Then there's also the enhanced mechanical qualification of a dissolution bath.
Another point with the PVT, they have difficulties to pass the test because of the limitation of the knowledge. Yeah.
But we tend to complete this together with the user. So if we do an IQ, we'll do a PVT test, but we complete it at the user's doing the PVT test under our guidance. Basically, we feel it's a performance verification, the performance of the apparatus with the user.
Mechanical testing is it's all very well to validate the instrument, but unfortunately it doesn't give you a perspective on how the operator interacts with the machines. And this is what the tablet test really does show up at the end of the day. It's the ability to follow an SOP and the ability to perform a dissolution test in a way which is reproducible from day to day.
There are some problems also with the short expiry of the tablets. And sometimes in Indonesia, when they buy tablets, it takes 3 months for the intent process. Yeah. And then when they receive the tablets, it is almost end of the expiry date.
Being a resource and letting your customer understand the difference between a performance verification test and the enhanced mechanical test will tell the customer how well versed you are in being able to support the equipment and also act as a resource for them. Because quite often, you know, they're focused on the release of their product. We're focused on how to be able to calibrate the system and how to maintain the system for the customer.
So now you have heard about dissolution validation, both in theory and practice, and about some of the local experiences. I hope it was interesting and worth your while. Thank you for your attention.